Welcome to the DevOps on Azure webinar series. You are watching the fifth part. In this topic, we will discuss why do we need version control. My name is Ágnes Kovács. I will be the host of this English version of the webinar. The webinar was developed originally by our Hungarian open source partner, Nextent. This webinar is also available in Hungarian language as well. So let us have a look at the agenda first. So we will first discuss how SCM is happened in the old times, and then we will also look at what is the purpose of version handling, what is the reason behind it, and we will have a look at version control systems like Git. We will discuss best practices regarding it, and we will at the very end review code review tools, and there will be also a demo to look at it. So, what is SCM? Let us go back a little bit into the ancient times. And if you remember, when you develop something, then you named it like file version 1 or version 0, version 1, version 2, and or whatever name came into your mind. And this practice did work for some times, but when the systems became more and more complex, it was visible that there will be a need for a version control system at the very end. Because when there was a need to change something, sometimes happened, and this is ill advice, so don't do that, that the change happened that you logged into the system or via FTP did the change ASAP, you had to fix it, and then this was very hard to maintain. And therefore, in the 70s, a version control system emerged. First, they were very simple, so just tracking files and the changes within them. But nowadays, since the requirements also changed, version control systems also support teamwork processes, and they assist your everyday work during development. And they are not just managing the versions, but also help you conduct code reviews, for example. We will discuss this later on. You can also track your changes, like enter comments into them, why this feature was done, what's the ticket ID, what was intended with this feature exactly, when it was completed, why it was completed, and also, as we will see during the webinar episodes, these tools are also integrated with continuous delivery systems, and we can automate whole build processes with it. There will be also a demo, demo for this at the end of the webinar. So, let's go on. There are a lot of version control systems out there, but we have picked Git because this is very, very well known and widely used. Also, previously SVN was used, so this was an older one, but now Git is the de facto industrial standard. It was developed by Linus Torvalds when he needed to move away the Linux code tree to another tracking system from a commercial one. And he was the creator of this. And if you think of Git, also you should think at GitHub and a lot of open source projects, and the whole ecosystem around Git is very, very active and very, very powerful. So let's have a look how Git works. First and the most prominent attribute of Git is that it is a distributed version control system. What does this mean? This means that each user has the whole copy of the code base, and this code base will contain all the changes performed in the history. So during the development, when we perform modifications on these local copies, and when we find these changes satisfying, then first we commit to our local index, and when we are done with our job, then we can push this to the remote repository. There may be not just one remote repository. Of course, there can be multiple ones, more than one. But for the sake of this webinar, we will use only one. So let's have a summary. So Git has a very simple way of doing things. You are doing modifications on your local copy, local index. You are committing your modifications. And once you are done, you are pushing it to the remote repositories. But next to these things, Git offers you some additional benefits or some additional features. The first one is that Git is able to deal with different branches. What does this mean? What does this mean? That you can have within these branches different copies of the source code. For example, if you are doing feature development, then you will not do directly modifications to the master version where your code lives, but you can do a feature branch and do the modifications there, develop the features on this branch. Tagging. Tagging is also an operation similar to the branching, but it is mostly used to label different milestones, for example, a given state of a release, or you can version it, like you can label it with 1.0 dot or whatever. So you can so that you can identify your changes later on. So the very also very important feature of Git is its ability to deal with conflicts. So compared, for example, to SVN, Git uses very good algorithms to detect and to resolve the conflicts that can happen during merging or rebasing. What is also kind of feature within Git that it is a very apt tool for brushing up or patches for reviewing. This also implies that some intentional falsification of change history can happen, and we will see this later on during interactive rebasing. Let's think about a little bit. So Git was originally developed for managing, like storing and versioning mostly of source code, like text files, etc. But this doesn't mean that it can only handle text-based files. It can also track binary files based on this original concept. You can use various add-ons to accomplish this. For example, Git LFS. This LFS stands for large file storage, or you can also use separate solutions like Git Annex to this. So let's move on and let's have a look first how a Git flow looks like. Before we go to the demonstration, let's have a look at which commands we have here. So first of all, how the flow starts. You have to obtain a repository. This can be accomplished by two ways. First of all, you can create one from scratch with the gitinit command, or we can obtain a copy from a remote repository, for example, from GitHub, then we can use Git clone instead. So after we have our source code in this repository, we can start modifying these files, making changes to them, and then we must add it to our local index via the git add command. This way, we have added these changes to this intermediary index area. But in order to actually send this to the local repository, changes to the local repository, we have to do a git commit. At this point, once we have committed this, we can add additional information for tracking, like ticket ID, etc. When we have done this, we can push this with git push command to the remote repository. If, of course, parallel to us, some other developers can also have done, for example, git push, and there may be other changes parallel to us. And if we would like to get these other changes, we can accomplish it with git fetch. And this command will synchronize our local repository with the remote one. And then we will be able to actually modify our local branches to incorporate the changes in the remote ones. Let's have a look at two things, merge versus rebase. When you are using Git, then we use branching for managing our development. And at some point, we will split our code base to two or more different branches. Of course, it is not advised to have that much of branches because it will have an administrative overhead, and it will greatly reduce the transparency of the process. So, but back to the branches, we start our development, optimally every feature is on a separate branch, and of course at this stage it is possible to do some changes on the master branch, like ASAP fixes or bug fixes, but usually the feature development happens on the feature branch. And when the feature is complete, we want to incorporate this into the master branch, and merge or rebase are two ways how to accomplish this. Let's have a look at some figurines. So here you can see a diagram. The first is for merge, the second is for rebase. So the first method is merging, and if you think it as a railway line, then it is like rejoining this to the major line. What does this mean technically? All changes that happened on the feature branch since the branching point, as shown here, are applied one by one to the master, resolving conflicts if they occur, and then the master label will point to the last of these applied changes. Let's have a look at the rebase. So that's the second figurine. The second method is actually about how to optimizing these changes for review. So technically, rebase means that all changes that happened on the master branch since the branching point, these will be applied one by one to the feature branch, and then the master label will point to this last of these applied changes. So this is the two ways how you can incorporate your feature to the master branch. Let's have a look at the review optimized code as mentioned previously. So first of all, what does this optimizing for review means? When we have finished a piece of code, then optimally not we are the only ones involved in this process. So it will be reviewed by others. Maybe it was developed by one more than one person. There are commits and patches sent to the same branch, and these patches needs to be reviewed. The main reason for this reviewing is actually to recognize and fix some possibly broken functionalities. Or to eliminate, for example, misunderstandings. And this happens because, of course, we developers are human, we are people, we make mistakes, and it is much easier for someone else to, let's say, spot some error in the code. And if you think about it, a code what it was modified is something what we actually read. And if you look at the time of a developer, then almost 90% of the time goes by reading the code, and 10% is actually going to writing this code. And therefore, it is super important that the code that comes out should be readable, should be optimized for this review. And when we think about back when we discussed merge and rebase, so rebasing gives us the means to reorder those commits that happened previously. And it is joining logically together the related ones, and makes it, makes the code more optimal for reviewing. And then these rearranged changes can be committed and pushed, and then we can also pull or push a request who's in charge of the remote repository. There are some tools there what can help us to have a code review. And the most prominent ones flawlessly support Git. Let's have a look at them. So first and most popular is GitHub. This is free for anybody as long as the repository are public, are accessible for public. There is GitLab. GitLab will be also introduced and demonstrated later on in this webinar. It has a fine UI as well for Git, and it can be used in continuous integration scenarios. There is another one. It is called Gerrit, and this is different from GitHub and GitLab in some ways, because it can display differences between Git changes, and also you can check the state between arbitrary versions or permanently annotate the code, etc. There is also Fabricator. Fabricator was designed by Facebook, and it is intended to support web development. And it has some features that the other tools didn't have. For example, it can also display changes of binary assets as well, what comes very handy in web-related projects when we have to compare, for example, between icons or images. And last one is Crucible by Atlassian. If you are familiar, for example, with Jira or Confluence, then you will find convenient. You will find Crucible convenient as well to use. And it is time for the demo. I'd like to show a small demo about what we have discussed so far. We already created a repository and cloned it locally. As you can see, it contains the following files. And the Git history is like this, as shown here. The first commit was an environment init, followed by the subsequent ones, and the comments you show what each of them does. If you want to actually see what a change does, then we can use the git show command and supply a name, as shown here. And I like to show an interactive rebasing and how it helps us to optimize our patches for review. So here you can see the output of the Git show. And if you take a look at this patch, then you see its comment contains the word fix up. What actually happened here is that the developer forgot to add a file to his previous commit and performed this addition later in this one. Most probably the file was already present at this local environment at the time of the commit, so locally even the test succeeded just like here. So as you can see, with the test completes successfully, they also succeeded, and when the commit reaches the test environment, there the file would be missing without this fix-up patch. So now we look at the history again. So these two patches actually belong together. They are incomplete without each other. So it would be nice if we, united them. It is very easy to do. All we have to do is to interactively rebase to the last unaffected commit. Here we can see that what commits happened since then. We locate the patch in this question as shown there. And so here is the first commit that we want to attach the next as a fix-up. And all we have to do is to do a prepend an F letter. And here is the fix-up shown among the possible commands. As you can see, Git gives us quite a lot of freedom to manipulate the patches. So when it is done, we save the file, exit the editor, and Git performs the rebasing accordingly. And if we list the Git history again, then we see that the fix-up patch disappeared as it has been unified with the preceding one. So that was the demo. We are at the conclusion. Let's have a summary. So first of all, there was a small introduction for Git. There was actually a very small one. We were just scratching the surface what Git can do for us. And just summarize in a nutshell. So we were looking at Git commands like Git init, Git clone. We discussed commit. We discussed also how to incorporate features from branches to the master work. We discussed merge versus rebase. We did a demo for them. In the demo, you could see an interactive rebase. And if you are interested more in Git, there are a lot of material out there, even interactive game, what can teach you how to use Git on a basic level or on an advanced level. And thank you very much for your attention. In the next episode, we will talk about testing, concepts, and theories.